The measure of how advanced a civilization is depends on its power usage. As humanity grows, we need more and more power to support better transportation infrastructures, better food storage and agricultural practices, better materials for construction, and better living conditions for all the new billions of people. These power demands, however, come with a cost. The cost of building, maintaining, and operating new power stations, bigger reactors, and unfortunately more coal and oil demands for those power stations. As we burn more coal, gas, and other non-renewable materials to create power, we release more dangerous chemicals into our delicate and vital atmosphere. Now, I'm not here to preach the dangers of climate change today, as I imagine most of you have heard hundreds of others talk it to death, but it is happening and will need to be dealt with in a way we currently aren't prepared for. Mainly switching over to renewable power sources, which would not only require more construction of those safer power generators, but a massive upheaval in the coal and oil industry. 9.8 million Americans alone work in the oil and gas industry, making up 5.6% of national employment. A complete shutdown of these industries would also be hard to sell to those who own and operate them. The percentages of power production in the United States is made up of 40% natural gas, 19% coal, 20% nuclear, and the other 21% is made up of hydropower, wind, solar, and other smaller renewable sources. And yes, if you couldn't already tell, I'm an American. Sorry about constantly using my country as an example. While emissions in the Western and European world have begun to stabilize, the entire world is still in a declining situation, and something will have to be done sooner than later. But what if we didn't have to build anything new here on Earth to achieve this? Where would this new and sustainable power source come from? The sun, of course. But we aren't talking about solar power, or at least solar power as we know. What if we were able to collect more sunlight than falls on Earth in its entire lifetime over the course of only a human lifetime? And how would we do that? Welcome back to Serious Science, and let's talk about Dyson spheres. Think about our sun for a moment. It's an unusually large and stable star compared to the average ones found in the rest of the universe, and it puts out an unimaginably large amount of light. Only about 0.02% of that light ever makes it to Earth's surface, as the rest is flying out in every other direction. That 0.02% is what we harvest with solar panels, and is the maximum amount we can receive without building solar panels in space. Even though an area the size of a small country covered in solar panels would be able to feed the entire world, the sun isn't always shining. There are cloudy days, dusty, inefficient panels, and that whole annoying nighttime thing. Plus, moving that power around to the rest of the world will become nearly impossible due to inefficient wires and heat losses. I talked about those issues in my last video on superconductors, which you can watch here. Is there a way we could create a space-based solar collection infrastructure? Absolutely. With enough funding, we could create a cloud of power-collecting satellites around Earth that would more than take care of our current power needs. But these satellites may be more trouble than they're worth, as they would create more man-made objects in orbit that we would need to dodge to get into space, and may begin to collide with each other, creating an impenetrable wall of debris that will last for hundreds of years. Now suddenly, we've created a new and harder problem to solve, while also confining us to the collection of only that 0.02% of sunlight, where more power needs in the future would require more crowding of our orbit. What if we put those satellites into orbit not around Earth, but around the Sun? They would be able to collect far more sunlight while also moving the dangers of a cascading collision into low solar orbit, where the debris would be vaporized quickly and safely. We would also be able to escape future power growth constraints, as we could simply build more power collectors around the Sun to meet the growing demands, avoiding the destruction of an inhabited world's orbit, like Earth's. This collection of power satellites that would encircle the Sun is called the Dyson sphere. It was originally a thought experiment devised by physicist and mathematician Freeman Dyson, who later regretted the name and changed it to a Dyson swarm, as the term sphere conjured images of gigantic rigid shells surrounding a star completely. Those rigid shells would be susceptible to asteroid impacts as well as orbital stresses and solar discharges. The whole structure would be likely to fall apart and sink into the star before too long. Instead, what he had envisioned would be a swarm of billions of solar collecting satellites, all beaming their power back to Earth using microwave transmitters and large receiver antennae stations on Earth. These satellites would collect electricity through the use of solar panels, then fire that energy towards Earth using a low-intensity microwave beam. The receiver stations would then transform these beams back into electricity through the use of electromagnetic excitement in the antenna. Now, if you think blasting Earth with billions of microwave beams sounds like a one-way ticket to everyone getting cancer, you'd be thinking like I was when I heard about this power transmission method. But this would not happen in the least. The microwave beams would be spread over a large area and would only strike collector antenna. The power of these beams would even be safe enough to stand in for short periods of time. They would not heat up the world either, as their power and effects are being collected entirely by these antenna, which could be cooled internally. They would also not affect the atmosphere, as tons of microwave radiation strikes Earth every second, all the time, without cooking us in the slightest. But we would not need one power-collecting station per power-beaming satellite, as the power satellites could direct all their beams at orbiting stations around the Earth, which would condense them into more concentrated beams, possibly even converting the microwaves in space and storing it in orbital batteries for deployment to Earth, or even act as a charging port for spacecraft. The power could also be collected at several orbital stations and transported down to Earth through space elevators or intermittent contact with launch loops. We could even take it one step further and create an orbital ring. This would be like creating the ring from Halo and putting it around Earth, since we like it so much. The ring would spin at the exact rate of Earth's rotation, keeping the ground underneath it stationary. It could then drop lines for spacecraft and cargo to climb without the need for supermaterials and space elevator tethers, which are still beyond our capability. But how would we even begin to build something like this? We would need more material to build the Dyson sphere than we could ever mine from Earth, if we still wanted to live on something that wasn't a molten ball of pockmarked rock. Where would we go for these raw metals and materials? Our solar system is incredibly lucky in that not only do we have a massive amount of free resources floating around, but a huge amount of those materials are orbiting close to the sun right now. The planet Mercury is pretty much a solid ball of metals and is quite close to the sun already, so we just need to harvest Mercury. Many of you may have chuckled to yourselves just then. Harvesting Mercury sounds like more work than the Dyson sphere itself. Not entirely, as we could send robotic drones to do most of the work for us, without having to worry about baking your human workers in the intense radiation and heat Mercury is bathed in. Okay, so we build a gigantic army of robots and ship them all off to dismantle Mercury and turn the raw metals into solar collecting satellites, right? Well, we could still cut one more corner, as our one and only shipment to Mercury could only consist of a few robots to begin with. Think about it, if we are going to Mercury to construct an army of orbiting robots, why not build material harvesters there as well? One robot lands and begins mining, while another set of robots convert those metals into more digging robots, then more smelters and constructors, which make more harvesters, and so on. But how do we power these robots? Solar power is obvious, but even Mercury rotates and has a night side. Well, that's simple. As we build our harvesters, they begin to build solar satellites. Those satellites that will someday provide Earth with power along with its billions of siblings will provide our first harvesting robots with power using the same methods we would use to collect that power back home. Those first satellites begin an industrial expansion never before seen by humanity, as they build more and more of themselves while using occasional expansions to the Dyson swarm to power themselves. If we needed to build the construction robots first without sending power collection satellites with them, we would still be able to use ground-based solar collectors on Mercury to jumpstart this industrial process. But how do we get our brand new solar power collecting satellites into space around the sun from the surface of Mercury? Continuous delivery rockets would need an exorbitant amount of fuel and would cost more than the Dyson sphere itself to construct and operate. Mercury has two qualities that will help in the offloading of satellites. It has a third of the gravity that Earth does, and it has no atmosphere to push through and fight. Something we will also have a lot of on Mercury is electricity, either from the power satellites themselves or from small solar farms on the planet's surface. This electricity could be used to power mass drivers. A mass driver is a pretty strange term, as it literally translates to a machine that pushes something, usually accelerating it towards a high speed. Even a colonial cannon could be called a mass driver, as it, well, drives mass. But the mass driver we would need would be something more like a long barrel that is loaded with a completed power satellite and then fired, sending that payload into space and even possibly right into a solar orbit. This would be done using electromagnets, sort of like a railgun for spacecraft. This cuts costs immensely, as the mass drivers need no fuel to run, can be used millions of times over before a need for repairs, and use no external sources of energy to do so, as they collect the sunlight falling onto the surface to run. These railguns could fire thousands of times per day, building up a complete Dyson swarm within a human lifetime, an incredible change for a single generation. But we can make this process even simpler, as billions of power-collecting satellites all beaming the power together would be unnecessary. We could build mirrors instead, that focus patches of collected sunlight onto larger energy-collecting satellites, reducing the need for more complex machinery. These mirrors would unfold like mile-wide umbrellas of super-thin metal foil, and would be cheap to replace as well as launch. They would also need fewer repairs, as they would contain very little in the way of complexity. But would this Dyson swarm block out all the light from the sun? Well, it absolutely could, but only if we built trillions of them, and were really bad at planning, as darkening Earth forever would probably be forefront in the first planning discussions. We could build a swarm in the shape of a wide ring or donut that could orbit the sun in a slanted direction, making sure that Earth and the rest of the solar system still gets light. We could even use this blocking of light to our benefit, as temporarily maneuvering patches of satellites into the path of Earth-bound sunlight would strategically reduce Earth's overall temperature. Amazing that the solution to our power needs for the next 5.5 billion years could also be the key to stopping what we've done to our planet in trying to obtain more power. So we've built a massive swarm of light-collecting mirrors that are providing Earth with more power than we could ever use currently. It has eliminated the need for any and all other power stations, as collection satellites around Earth could be positioned in multiple different spots in orbit, possibly even geosynchronous ones. A geosynchronous orbit is the point at which the height of your orbit around the Earth has slowed to the point that you orbit over one specific spot constantly, hovering over that spot for as long as you can keep the orbit. This would mean that power could be beamed from the sun, collected by these satellites, and be beamed to the night side of the planet, providing constant and reliable solar power for the entire world. Now, what do we do with all this extra power? Power amounts so large that all of humanity's power generation over its entire existence, multiplied by 1,000, still wouldn't even come close to a single percent of our new system. We could beam that energy elsewhere in our solar system, to other orbital infrastructures. We could power distant mining operations that scoop Jupiter for hydrogen without bringing a single reactor with us. We could illuminate Pluto as if it were Earth, or power city ships bound for other stars. We could blast open holes in space-time using the as-of-yet unimaginable amounts of power we would have, and do things that we currently cannot comprehend. With the power of an entire star, humanity would be able to complete projects most of us imagine only godlike alien races could build. With more power comes more advances in how to use that power, like with better batteries creating better motors or wiring. What advancements would be made to match this new unlimited power source? We could even use that power to mine the sun itself, as it is not only made up of gas and dust, but also everything the planets are made of, and a whole lot more of it. We would be able to send massive pulses of magnetism down to blast away at the roiling furnace of raw materials below, and could build megastructures directly from the sun. This would have no ill effect on our sun's lifetime, as smaller stars with less materials burn slower and more efficiently. We would actually be extending our sun's lifetime by mining it, and therefore Earth's lifetime as well. The jump in our power and abilities would be so monumental that we cannot begin to imagine what our future selves would use it for. We would become a completely self-sufficient and renewable species. Many scientists believe the Dyson swarm is so obvious a solution to a race's power needs that aliens would make the same judgment. There could be thousands of Dyson swarms crossing the universe, and they would be easy to spot with enough observation. We would have the power to become one of the alien races we write about in fiction. Vast, unimaginably powerful, and the rulers of uncountable star systems, even our entire galaxy. It would take a monumental effort from all of Earth's countries and a lifetime of work, but the payoff would catapult humanity into an age of prosperity and plenty never before dreamed of. And the best part? We could start today. We have the technology. All we need is the push, hopefully before it's too late, and our efforts to create a minuscule amount of power from coal and oil don't destroy that future. The humanity of tomorrow just got a bit closer, and all we have to do now is commit. Thank you for watching.